my little flowers. Welcome to the channel. My name is Sunny. So what I'm gonna do today is I'm going to do my best to make sure that I just record in one take and edit as I can. So it might not be pristine, but this took a lot of effort for me to produce and I'm running out of time to upload it. So yeah. Okay guys, so ironically, I found myself genuinely disinterested in writing essays in both high school and in college. You know, I hated writing essays, even if it were about subjects that intrigued me. Was it the suffocating formalities that came with formatting an essay? The fact that I never really got to choose the subject? Or was it the strict deadlines that led me to harsh procrastinating? Well, you know, it was probably all of the above. I'm not so sure what changed now to suddenly fill me up with this sense of vigor and inspiration to write about this particular topic. I do feel a bit better that I'm able to write on my own terms about something that I've contemplated at length and thought a lot about. I did a lot of research, talked to a few people on their opinions, and I came up with this. I'm mainly writing this for my own sake, to take the questions and arguments swirling around in my own head and put them to paper, write them down, substantiate them, and see if they mark the page with anything meaningful. I'm putting a lot of work into producing this video, even though I'm fully aware that my feelings on the subject might change drastically in the future. So today I want to talk to you about why your art matters, or why I think your art matters way more than you think it does, and asking what that means for artists. What kind of responsibilities do we hold? But first, I'd like to introduce you to a few examples of the strength of art, what power it has to influence society, and later we'll get to what that might mean for you as an artist. While I was sitting in my art history class, our professor gave us an assignment which was to make a presentation of an artist from a particular art movement and present it to the class. We needed to choose an artist who accurately reflected the art movement they belonged to at the time, and who was someone we could stylistically relate to. You know, the questions we needed to answer were pretty much, how did they present their artwork, and how did their choice of both medium and subject reflect the social conditions they were living through at the time? When working on this, I started to really consider those two, the medium and the subject. They seem to be the biggest, most important parts of really contextualizing an artwork. I had to dig into the history of a particular art movement, the philosophies it characterized, and how it influenced society as a result of its chosen expression. Due to my tastes as an artist, I was suggested to be assigned to the social realism movement in Russia, and in particular, I chose Marie Bri to represent as my subject. If you're unfamiliar though, the social realism movement in Russia was created with the logic of being a self-fulfilling prophecy. The Russian government would promote artists who had certain ideals that reflected the Russian Communist Party's most idealized version of its citizens. It was such a successful tool for social management that it became the official art style, if you will, of Russia. In 1934, a huge debate was sparked, as it was really questioned what the ideal image of the proletariat or common man should look like. The newly formed USSR really wanted to exemplify an image of what society should look and behave like. And guess what? It was decided that since artists themselves were workers and the Communist Party aligned themselves with the common man, artists should be the perfect group of people to idealize the proletariat as they themselves were seen. The art style often placed a lot of emphasis on the ordinary worker, how they were an extremely important cog in the machine, a pillar, if you will, of an entire society. These subjects tended to either be extremely simplistic or entirely revolutionary. The medium used in a lot of these pieces were posters. Marie's main medium, in fact, was creating such posters that could be mass distributed and widely influential, as opposed to some of the oil paintings of the time, which were still influential, but not as easily accessible to the public. It's hard to tell if Marie would have chosen poster art as her medium of choice if she wasn't a woman. as materials for creating posters was often much cheaper and easier to obtain than materials in studio spaces, which were scarce and only preserved for men. In fact, as a result of the medium being not only useful for public propaganda, but also much easier for underprivileged groups such as these women to access, a bunch of these semi-successful and promoted artists were themselves women. Women who got a little bit of say in how this particular social movement was perceived. And as a result, social realism in the USSR became ever so subtly pro-women's rights. Some of us might not realize it, but the impact of art and its use as propaganda or even the base of great social movements throughout human history was not a coincidence. Art is extremely powerful and has great potential to manipulate an audience depending on how well crafted it is. Many social movements, such as the feminism movement, civil and queer rights movements, are accompanied and amplified by art at the time. Many art movements in themselves, such as the Mexican muralism movement, are a spark of and subsequent result of social movements. So, similar to the Russian social realism movement, you might be familiar with Rosie the Riveter, a key figurehead when considering and conceptualizing the feminism movement. And it's no secret why. Her bold stance that draws you in, surrounded by vivid colors and simplistic silhouette, it's something that I bet you can think of without even looking at her in recent memory. Even with a 15-second gaze at that powerful poster, it sticks to you without even realizing it, and it's a piece of powerful symbolism. But let's think of something that might have a little bit more of a tangible impact on the common viewer. Let's take the case of film, for example. I was recently watching a video by Curio, where Natalie was speaking on the way abortion was viewed and portrayed in the media, and her own experiences with it. It was a really nice video, which gave me the idea to talk about the subject in the first place, even if it's not super related, and I really do recommend it if you want to check it out. Essentially, she made the argument that regardless of intention of the artist, or even the viewer, the way the situation is framed down to the tiniest subtlety can influence how the audience understands the message of the film. Essentially, it has a lot to do with framing. How the media fails many times to portray a well-rounded experience of abortion in place of tropes that are shallow or exploited to be dramatic. A lot of the time, it really misses the mark, and that has such harsh consequences on people who are affected by abortion legislations. It's not at all uncommon to hear about a film drastically changing the public perception on a common issue. Think about what impact Jaws did to the shark population and contributing overall to its terrible rap. So I've been beating you over the head with it. Yes, art is powerful. Very, very powerful, and there are many examples as to why. And yes, this of course means that artists should expect to put careful thought into what they're producing, due to the impact that it might have on the world around them. But what happens when art is misinterpreted in a completely unforeseeable way? An example of good intention but unfortunate misinterpretation was given where filmmaker Diablo Cody, who created Juno, which was heavily involved in the portrayal of abortion. Diablo Cody, who was notably pro-choice, was horrified to receive an email from her Catholic high school thanking her for her contribution to showcasing pro-life narrative. I could not imagine how that must have felt as an artist. She said that she felt she had a responsibility to be more explicit in arguing for pro-choice, and she regrets not doing so. Even if she couldn't possibly predict how the world would change in years to come. On the topic of why Juno didn't get an abortion, she was quoted saying, "But I don't feel I was clear enough in terms of why Juno chose not to have an abortion. It was simply because she did not want to. It was not about any type of feeling that abortion was wrong. I'm pro-choice. So for it to be interpreted as an anti-choice movie was upsetting to me." Though many people perceived this movie that advocated for pro-choice, it's still telling how a number of interpretations ended up being exactly the opposite, despite the filmmaker's intention. So the question is, whose responsibility is it when art turns out to be the face for an ideal or movement when it's quite obviously unintended? Take, for example, the commonly used quote, "Blood is thicker than water." Many people use this line as a reason to justify how blood-related family bonds are stronger and more important than bonds outside of a family. But the original saying actually went, as many people know now, "The blood of the covenant is thicker than the water of the womb." How this phrase turned out to fuel an argument that is completely opposite to the intentions of the person who coined it, it's really interesting to think about. And that makes many people wonder, how could it possibly be the artist's fault for such unforeseeable outcomes to even occur? I think something to keep in mind when creating art is that your art matters, obviously. And not enough people really realize that. The emotions, feelings, thoughts, colors that you put into your artwork has the outcome of an audience being influenced by it in one way or another. Whether you choose to calm the mind, call one to action, highlight a problem, or suggest a solution, it can be done. And while the medium can influence the way your message comes across, it doesn't really change the common denominator. As it is said, with great power comes great responsibility. Regardless of your intention, you have the power that sits behind your message. And while a healthy bit of separation of artist and art does and should exist, an artist still holds a little bit of responsibility as well. They're responsible for being responsible. A famous professor of philosophy from Johns Hopkins University puts it, "It is at this point that the social responsibility of the artist, whether his personal ambition, arises. He is one of the few people who leave their works behind them. Most of us die, leaving but the most evanescent traces of our existence. A few words, a few acts, a child or two, a name in the family Bible, a tombstone, and even these sink into oblivion after a few years. But as long as a picture, a book, a building remains, it remains the objectification of a man's thoughts, his feelings, his repressions, his hope, his hatred, his love. He himself may disappear, as so the painters of the Byzantine tradition, but so long as the works survive, someone will look at them and will interpret them as he pleases. That the interpretations will often be incorrect in the sense that they are not foreseeable by the artist is undoubtedly true, but that merely adds to the obligation to be as clear as possible." So, in other words, sometimes it's quite impossible to predict how a viewer might understand your art. The interpretation they take away from it might almost entirely depend on that particular viewer's own personal experiences and beliefs. But one cannot ignore that the artist played a part, no matter how small, in creating that art to be interpreted in the first place. If a large enough group of people take away a widely similar narrative that is opposed to the one you wanted to portray, then the artist might be interested in reinvestigating the way they frame their subjects. Although we are not always like the social realists, who carefully craft and guide an audience towards a certain interpretation, we do have the power to do so. And thus, a reason to question what our outcomes are reasonably going to be. While a healthy separation between art and artists should exist in the first place, we as an audience cannot ignore the initial connection. And so artists themselves should try their best to be aware of it. We will be interpreted, used, propagandized maybe even. We will have influence, we will have voice, and we may have very little say in how that voice is used once our brush leaves the canvas, pen arises from paper, last note is sung. Which, in my opinion, adds even more credence to our self-awareness. And in that, it's my opinion that one should take a second to look back and wonder, conceptualize, the impact that this piece of artwork might have on the world. No matter how small you think you are, how little influence you think you have, please keep in mind, your voice has power. Don't underestimate it. And understandably, we can't always predict what people will take away from our messages. We're not always fortune tellers. I've heard often that in a persuasive essay, you should avoid straddling the fence on a point. But the truth is that I really don't know where to stand yet. I'm still trying to figure out how to feel about this issue, and I really wanted to write out my concerns and try to make other artists aware of their powerful voice that exists through art. The world is a bit more nuanced than I can give answer for at this point. How much are artists even accountable for? Are we responsible even for the smallest opinion? Or is it just what we leave on the painting that matters, and not the interpretations of others? Thank you so much for watching, if you made it this far. I rewrote the script many, many times to make sure that I was very comfortable with the point, or lack of point, I was making. I certainly hope that you got a little bit out of thinking on this concept with me. And if you have your own opinions, feel free to share. Even if you just came by to listen to my voice and watch me paint, you're awesome, and I appreciate you. So don't forget to like and subscribe if you haven't already, and I'll see you in the next video. Qu'il est cosmique cet ennui, dois-je recourir à la science, anesthésier l'insomnie? A good way, words, as George a famous philosophy professor, voice.